Hi, welcome to the University of Newcastle's first Looking Ahead lecture series. My name is Nathan Towney. I'm the Pro Vice Chancellor of Indigenous Strategy and Leadership here at the University. It gives me great pleasure to acknowledge the traditional custodians of this land, the land where I live and work, the land where my two children were born. It's a very special place to me, the land of the Awabakal Nation. I pay my respects to the Awabakal people, elders past and present, and also acknowledge the homelands of everyone here in the audience, as well as online. When I acknowledge country, I am referring to the land, the water, the sky, all the living things that occupy those spaces, and also the unique relationships that exist between all those things. Tonight we are talking about the paradox of a pandemic, and there is no doubt that the pandemic has had a major influence on human behaviour and us as humans. However, I think it's fair to say that our planet is breathing a sigh of relief. We are having less planes in the air, less cars on the road, and people are connecting more with nature. Our rivers and creeks are clearer. We have record low pollution levels, and I personally have noticed more bees, butterflies, and birds in my own backyard. 2020 has been a difficult year, but I'm sure we will get through it. It gives me great pleasure to welcome everybody to the first of our lecture series, and I would now like to hand over to our Vice-Chancellor and President, Alex Zielinski AO.
Good afternoon and welcome to our launch of our Looking Ahead lecture series. So, Nathan, thank you for your acknowledgement of country. Nathan is one of our outstanding leaders in the university and an outstanding leader in the Indigenous community. The lecture series is actually inspired by our strategic plan, Looking Ahead, which we launched earlier this year. And it's about very much centred on two things, an outstanding student experience and serving our communities. And out of that, we hope to create a university that is world-leading for our regions. So to have a lecture series which is actually reaching out to the community is so, so important. The themes you'll see in the throughout the series is things that reinforce the values of our university. We stand for excellence, equity, engagement and sustainability. So in regards of engagement, no better thing to do than do a lecture series. And it's also about reinforcing the excellence of our people here that work at this university and can inform our community about important issues. But it'll all be done through the lens of equity and sustainability. You'll hear important lectures delivered throughout the year. We'll be doing it on a monthly basis. Now, it's great to see the very first lectures when it kicked off by one of our leaders in the education, humanities and the arts, and that's John Fischetti, who'll be giving the lecture. I think a provocative title in the sense of the paradox of a pandemic, and he's got a great panel accompanying him tonight. But I just wanted to say a couple other things tonight, is that we'll be reinforcing the strategic initiatives of our plan through our lecture series. We live in the Asia Pacific. This area has been actually the centre of the epicentre of the pandemic. And it's gone global, but we need to be thinking, what is our place as a university? How do we serve our region? We also have to think about how do we graduate our graduates to be ready for the challenges of the world. So we are seeking to produce life-ready graduates. We'll also seek to have engagement priorities around the industries that matter and the businesses of the future that matter for our region. We'll also be looking to reimagine our campuses. Today, I'm sitting in one of our biggest lecture, standing in one of our biggest lecture theatres on the campus and talking to a very small audience, but I know there's 781 people registered online out there. So that's how things are moving. We're moving from the physical to digital. So we have to think about how do we reimagine our university operating in this world. And of course, we can't do it without inspiring people, inspiring our people here at the university and inspiring people in the region to come together to solve the challenges. COVID-19 is certainly challenging us and challenging Australia, challenging the globe. Universities have a big place in helping to find the solution, and we're here at the beginning of that solution. So one of the things we have at our university is not just outstanding staff, but it's also outstanding students. So tonight, I'm very pleased to welcome one of our stellar fourth year students, Ru Vinasugu, who's going to do the introduction of John Fischetti. Over to you, Ru. Thank you.
Thank you for the introduction, Professor Alex. My name is Rubimbo Visango and I'm a fourth year mechanical engineering student here at the university. When I was 8 or 9 years old, I fell in love with reading and I would read anything that had words on it. And when I was 11 years old, I wrote my first book. And now this book was almost entirely plagiarized right from the cover to the end. The only difference though, was that the characters in my book had brown skin and brown eyes. They had wide noses and kinky hair. They looked like me. So for as long as I have been able to comprehend the world, I have been aware that society may allow people who look like me to exist, but never to fully belong. In fact, I think the act of carving out your own space of belonging is something of an act of defiance. I started my studies in 2016 as an international student living on campus, and in true student fashion, I never checked my emails. And so when the electricity went off one afternoon, I didn't know what was happening, but I thought, well, at least my laptop's charged, I can continue binge watching Grey's Anatomy. And when I went out into the common room and was met with my housemates, one of them, who was really close to me at the time, said to me, oh, you didn't see the email as well? And at that point, I still hadn't seen it. And I said, you know, what email? And she said, you know, the one about the maintenance. That's why the electricity is out. And I was taken aback. And I said, wait, so this doesn't happen regularly? Like, you guys just have electricity all the time? And she giggled and said, yeah. And I was shook. And I said, hold on, what about water? Do you guys just have water running out of your taps all the time? And she said, yeah, pretty much. And I remember that tangible moment of realization between the two of us, that even though we had met and clicked from the get-go and had so much in common, the fact that we had been raised in two different places meant the way in which we had experienced the world was so different. One speaker that I listened to once said, the two biggest determiners of how your life will turn out are number one, where you're born, and number two, who you're born to. And none of us get to pick any of those two things. One other thing that I think is also overlooked that we also don't get to pick is the way in which the world experiences us. I think in the midst of a mass social awakening, it would be remiss of me to begin telling you of my experience as an international student through this pandemic without first acknowledging the privilege that it is to even afford an overseas education. And depending on where they're from, for some international students, studying overseas wasn't just a desire, but a necessity. For those students, coming here to study overseas meant liberation from faulty education systems, job insecurity, and so much more. What a lot of us have longed for through this pandemic as human beings has been a sense of certainty. But certainty hasn't been something a lot of international students have been able to afford during these times. From the life encroaching uncertainties of when will I get to see my family again, or where will my next meal come from, to the smaller, often overlooked uncertainties such as when will I be able to go back to school? But what is paradoxical though about that statement is that you don't have to have been or be an international student to have felt a deep sense of uncertainty during these times. But oftentimes, in dealing with our own trauma, we tend to other the people who don't quite look and think like us. The ones who may be in the same boat with us now, but because they didn't quite get here in the same way that we did, we label them as other, and in doing so, we unconsciously afford them just a little less humanity. this university has outpoured support into its international student community. This support has looked like financial assistance in grants, vouchers, and interest-free loans that international students have been able to easily access. It's looked like mental health support on accessible platforms, the nightly free meals from the on-campus accommodation for the students doing it tough. My favorite writer, Maya Angelou, said, "When you know better, you do better." And I think it sounds really simple, but it's really not, because it takes a great deal of humility to let the people who you are serving tell you what they need. It takes humility to want to know better, because it means acknowledging that you haven't always gotten it right in the past and that there is room to know better. And as I have stepped out and defiantly left behind the comforts of silence, what I have encountered here is a community that is passionate and dedicated to knowing better. And I think it's so well represented in our continual propensity to doing better. I am so honored tonight to introduce Professor John Fischetti, the Pro Vice Chancellor of the Education and Arts Faculty here, a renowned researcher, speaker, and integral part of this university's community. His work continues to challenge individuals across the globe to do better.
Thank you, Rue. Hard act to follow. Good evening to everyone at home and in this audience, and what a special honor it is for one of Australia's newest citizens to present to you the inaugural lecture series in this Looking Ahead series that we're about to launch tonight. Thank you for coming. Let's get busy understanding the paradox of a pandemic. I'd like to follow on Nathan's amazing acknowledgement and acknowledge all Aboriginal people who are able to be on with us tonight who may see this in the future. And as I've worked with Auntie Bronwyn, our wonderful elder in residence, and the amazing Aboriginal community, particularly represented at the Wallatooka Institute, three things stand out that I take on board every day and that I offer to you as I acknowledge the opportunity to be on the land of the Awabakal people and the Pamelong clan's homeland and country. The first is, and these are all related, by the way, to this pandemic and what we might take from the learning of 60,000 years of amazing Indigenous history in this country. The first is that we learn from and listen to our elders. If there's anything that all this is really about, it's about trying to protect the opportunity to protect our most vulnerable, but actually our wisest and those who we learn the most from. The second is to take care of our families, our clan, our mob, the people around us. We might even have met some neighbors we didn't know. What an special time it is to learn from and to take care of our family and our neighbors. And the third is to take care of this planet. And you might have realized that as we started out this year of 2020 with lots of smoke and lots of bushfires, the country was angry. And there's some things I'd like to say about that tonight. So for 60,000 years of Indigenous history and 7 years of trying to take some of that on board, my gratefulness to all Indigenous people who are able to be with us tonight. We stand on your shoulders. Moving through this amazing period of human history, we're faced with some striking paradoxes in how we understand, cope with, and move forward inside our new COVID reality. The purpose of this lecture is to explore some of the paradoxes and to challenge ourselves to take positive action to ameliorate the ongoing inequities in our society and take the opportunity to change, adopt, and advance the common good. And to look ahead. This evening, I'm not in any way attempting to take light at the subject of this global tragedy. Hundreds of thousands of people have died, millions more are infected, and we actually don't know the end point of this until a vaccine is actually available. What we're attempting to do is point out paradoxes, not make light of a very big global tragedy. I call this the end of the beginning of this new normal. We've actually just started to deal with the implications of COVID-19. The easy part was from February or March till today. The hardest part is integrating COVID-19 is a reality for the foreseeable and potentially the long-term future. And I call this normal X, in part a tribute to my algebra teacher who taught me about variables in school, but also this is an unknown world and reality we're in, and I'm not sure we really want to go back to normal as it was. And so I've called upon some of the best spokespeople of the 20th century and now into the 21st to tell us a little bit more of the reality that we face. It's pretty confronting to see some of the world's largest cities completely empty. And I know as you've been able to look online and go through your social media feeds, you've seen places all around the world, very strange realities in 2020. And it might have taken the Rolling Stones doing a video from home to protect their vulnerable cells to put it in really good perspective of most of the world has been like a ghost town. So in this paradox of a pandemic, we might have to realize, what is a pandemic? And what is a paradox? And a paradox is a statement or a proposition that seems self-contradictory or absurd, but in reality expresses a possible truth. Two conflicting pieces of information you're forced to deal with at the same time. And a pandemic is something that is wide, and we don't know when it's going to end. It's ongoing. And this thing is a paradox inside a pandemic. These street signs are rather confronting. Which way do I go? I'm not sure. It's all confusing me, as well as this sign, which I'm not really sure what to say. I don't know how to understand it. It tells me I'm not supposed to have a sign, and it's a sign. This evening, I want to share this paradox in five areas, and there could have been many more, but I've just chosen five I think are as pointed as needed for this first lecture in the lecture series. In economic inequity, impacts on women, schooling from home, health and well-being, and social change. And for the next few minutes, I'll outline some of the paradoxes that are emerging in these areas. So I think the most interesting issues of paradox are in the economic inequity area. Australia has 13 million workers, and this pandemic has divided us into one of three categories. So 40% of us are knowledge workers. Another 40% frontline workers, and 20% those who are un or underemployed. Knowledge workers are those who are the happiest being able to work from home and have the means and wealth to be able to be flexible enough to educate their own children without a lot of discomfort. Frontline workers are those who are our heroes, the hero nurses, the hero teachers, the hero bus drivers and grocery clerks, the hero people who have kept the society going and put their health at risk on a daily basis to keep things going. Increasingly, those people who are most happy are already the people most able to endure a catastrophe or a crisis. And interestingly, and probably knowingly for many of the parents out there, young people are the most affected. And revealingly, median wages for those most affected are 40% lower than the rest of us. It's no wonder why, in a housing project in Melbourne, COVID would go rampant. The density of the population, the lack of ventilation, you'll notice no patios on the apartments, and how people living densely together, who actually work in high-dense places like poultry packing plants, are more susceptible to this disease. But young people are bearing the brunt of this in ways that they're willing to reveal to us. And many are now calling this Generation COVID.
I just got an email today saying that I didn't get the job for one of them, so the rat race to finding a job continues on.
Most salons weren't looking for work, so yeah.
Myself and so many others just lost our jobs like that.
It is really hard in this climate when everyone's looking for something, when you don't have specific qualifications.
And now I'm looking back at my parents, that's going to be really weird.
I've been lucky enough to get on JobKeeper, which has been fantastic because I'm actually making more money than I was pre-COVID.
My employer took up the JobKeeper scheme and my income has been reduced, unfortunately.
I definitely have learnt that I need to become way better with money.
I'm not as happy or as confident as I used to be.
The anxiety I felt was through the roof. I never really felt it before to this extent.
Sometimes just laying around thinking it's just way too much.
I feel like COVID-19 kind of gave me time to myself. Time to work on my reading, gaming, keeping me sane, keeping me intact, not thinking about what's happening out there.
Some people aren't excited to go back to school because they're scared that they're going to die or they're going to infect someone old around them.
It really impacted my motivation to study.
I don't think that I'll ever be the same after this. It's kind of one of those life-defining moments. I think about the future in a really negative light now.
We can never have complete control over everything, and that's okay. But what we do have control over is the way that we respond to situations and the way that we react to them.
I really hope that it makes us as a society way more compassionate.
We have to change up our lifestyle, change up how we live.
It's quite anxiety-inducing to have to think about kind of a post-COVID world.
I feel uncertain on how life will resume after all of this.
For me, that's been a massive wake-up call that things can change super fast. And it's definitely been a powerful message for me to take life by its reins.
It's a real paradox that for some young people, they've never made more because of job seeker than they did under New Start before. It took a pandemic to get them the wages necessary just to survive in their transitions between one job and the next. So this COVID reality is actually disproportionately affecting young people, the poor, and a broad range of vulnerable populations. One of the particular populations that's most disconcerting is the impacts on women. And a predominantly female workforce in the health industry has actually put many women at the front lines of putting themselves and their families at risk. The increase in caring responsibility during this crisis has actually been increasingly and inappropriately or disproportionately shouldered by women. Air travel, tourism, the food industries, beverage and garment industries, manufacturing industries are significantly impacted by what's been the reality of this economy, and they have a higher than typical population of women who work in those industries. And even more atrocious and confronting is the fact that 243 million women and girls have been experiencing sexual or physical or violent intimate partner relationships in the last 12 months. And the rate of violence against women and girls, particularly domestic violence, has increased during COVID-19. Just Google searches have gone up 75% on issues related to family and domestic violence.
There's an increasing body of evidence supporting the idea that as a group, women are being particularly adversely affected. First, there's domestic violence. The UN has called the increase in domestic violence globally the shadow pandemic. It says across the world, domestic violence helplines and shelters are reporting rising calls for help. Professionally, women seem to be at a disadvantage too. This article in the science journal Nature says preliminary data suggests that across disciplines, women's publishing rate has fallen relative to men's amid the pandemic. Whilst analysis of households with two opposite gender parents from the Institute of Fiscal Studies in the UK has suggested that compared to fathers, mothers are more likely to have quit or lost their job or to have been furloughed. They're also spending less time on paid work, but more time on household responsibilities. A separate study from the University of Sheffield found that the proportion of mothers responsible for most of a family's childcare increased from 27% to 45% during lockdown.
Some of the most striking paradoxes are actually in schooling from home, which many of you have experienced online and in this audience tonight. One of the first issues that arose was young people were asked to study from home and teachers to plan for kids to study from home is that 2.5 million Australians actually don't have access to the internet. And that put the most vulnerable, again, out of touch with the ability to stay connected to their school. There were some schools where packets were prepared the old-fashioned way, using photocopiers to develop packages of materials that parents could come pick up because the kids and they had no access, or if they did have access, it was for one laptop that had to be used by the mom, the dad, the carer to conduct their work from home so their child could continue their schoolwork, while other schools handed out laptops fully loaded with e-textbooks and the other sources and materials and platforms in which young people could have their individual journey. Think of that gap and how it's been revealed so strikingly. One of the other paradoxes is some families have gotten to spend some time together they wouldn't have, doing some learning. So if you could afford to, you had the extra tool and your internet actually worked, you have to spend lovely time like this mom and her child. It's also thrown, particularly for year 12 students this year, in chaos, right? And many of those young people have been reeling from the stresses that come from what's this mean for me and what will it impact for us. However, if we had said in January to most of the educators who have a future-focused lens out there, and you know who you are, you would be really happy to know that during the last few months, we have not just gone through basic learning, we've been working on accepting change. Have we been trying to do that? Honoring flexibility, thriving in ambiguity. I got 2 master's degrees in that since March, you might have 3. Practicing self-regulation, which is an education term, which actually means like taking control of your own learning. There's a lot of young people now who own their learning because teachers put out some little sketchy stuff, a little bit cryptic, and they had to figure it out, use what was at home. That's actually pretty good. And promoting the common good, which we might have learned over 60,000 years is not a bad thing to do. And in the eyes of many children, they were able to engage in ways that kept them happy, kept them positive, and keep them moving forward. These are some parents' feedback, however, and you'll notice the paradoxes strikingly. Kevin says it's a bloody nightmare. Christy says, so far we've been able to make it work, and we've been able to work it around our school schedule. Samantha says, boy, it's harder than I thought. And Rachel said, I'm feeling optimistic. We've got great communication from our daughter's school. We have faith in the teachers and staff who are working so hard. Matt is not so sure. He's completely out of his depth. Little direction from the schools and the teachers, and they're winging it. And Natalie's so stressed and sad because she has her own mom as her teacher. I think it took about a day for most parents to realize how amazing teachers are. And I'm one of the fortunate ones who can work from home. I have no idea how I'm going to juggle this if we have to do it another term or we have to go back and doing it. That was from Caitlin. And of course, this young man has decided the best of all possible worlds is to be online and in your hammock. That's the way to do school, right? In health and well-being, and I know I'm talking online here to some of the world's best experts, but this picture represents to me a lot of what we've seen and you might have seen as you went to your own shopping trips during the last few months. You may not be aware that 70% of Australians are now drinking more. 32% are concerned about that. I'm not sure about the other 38%. 20% are drinking earlier in the day. 28% now more on their own. And I'll just pause for a minute of what that means to our society. This is across class lines socioeconomically and really puts a strong light on some issues that are coming out of COVID we're going to have to reckon with. And women in child caring roles reported drinking more during particularly the lockdown period, and I'm sure in Victoria right now are facing those stresses and issues as women, as we already have mentioned, have borne a lot of the brunt of this. And mental health issues of youth have really been affected. This data, if you look at depression, anxiety, and stress in 18 to 24-year-olds and then over 25, in the areas of from April to June, the usual Australia score is the black line. And you see for all of us, we've been registering like on the meter at tilt level, but young people in particular really taking it hard. And I know I'm talking to people online who have young people in their own homes and a few of our own students who or online, we're going to have to look out for each other. This may be the number one issue we face now and post-COVID, is helping and assisting ourselves get back to whatever good mental health is. And meanwhile, the Australian government decided a couple of weeks into this thing that the rules against telemedicine were off, and now we could actually have a consultation with our GP online. And that's likely to continue post-COVID. So there's a paradox. Isn't that good news in amongst all of that really hard to take information? In food security, Australia is better off than most countries because of the plethora of food. We have plenty. We actually discard about 30% of the food in Australia on a daily basis that we actually just throw away. But the food supply is not a quantity issue, but an equity one. 4 in 5 parents say coronavirus lockdown has brought families closer together. So in amongst the extra things that might not be going well, that's a good thing, right? We've increased our time together, and two lovely families just enjoying hanging out. They may have run out of things to watch on Netflix by then. For children whose families are financially stable, food secure, and able to provide the tech resources needed for distance learning at home, the quarantine might have actually been sort of a reset. We'll see. The reset button, we got to hold off. We thought we were pushing it. We haven't pushed it yet. It's different in terms of food scarcity in other parts of the world. This little video is from the US for just a few seconds to talk about what happens when families across all the class spectrums actually run out of food.
Tonight, with millions of Americans still waiting for those stimulus checks and 10% of Americans out of a job in 3 weeks, long lines for food becoming a new normal. These cars lined up in Los Angeles.
Certainly, it is a point that it is so needed that this many people did show up.
I'm pregnant right now with a very high-risk pregnancy, it really helps a lot.
And in Plano, Texas, where Cheryl Jackson runs a food pantry.
I am so thankful to to every person that's got out of their house, came out of their house and donated one box of cereal for another family to be able to eat. I'm grateful.
The Hernandez family in Miami, grateful too.
How much does this help out?
Let me tell you, and now it's getting worse because you go to the supermarkets and things are getting, you don't see nothing, the shelves are empty.
They just picked up enough food to last their children a few days. Miami-Dade County Public Schools distributing more than 700,000 meals since schools were shuttered. For those whose jobs are considered essential, many are risking their lives for that paycheck. 59-year-old Vitalina Williams worked as a part-time cashier at this Salem, Massachusetts grocery store, also checking receipts at a nearby Walmart. She died on Saturday after a week in the hospital.
My last memory of her, seeing her sitting there in her coat, in her blue little hat, and leaving her at the emergency room.
She's believed to be the first grocery worker in the state to die with the virus.
There's been also fears it'd be a major blood shortage, and around the world there actually is, and in parts of Australia. But remarkably, in Newcastle, we've set a record with over 200 units per month extra being donated during this time. Novocastrians have actually risen to the occasion, and our blood stocks are full, should there be the need, both for normal health issues and for pandemic-related ones. Pretty fantastic to live in a community that's actually risen to the occasion to protect one another. In terms of social change, I'm not sure any of us in January would have realized that it would take a pandemic to create a movement, and a global movement that's housed even in this community as well. That Black Lives Matter would be a real phenomenon, leading to the efforts to push and promote for change in legislation. In Newcastle, two protests that have taken place have been spearheaded by our own students, who went to the Supreme Court and got the constitutional challenges upheld to the right to free speech and protest, assuming that social distancing would be followed. So we played a lead role in promoting social change. And it's more than social change, it's actually legislative change. Because as you're probably aware right now, incarceration rates around the country skew in terms of brown and black men. And I'll share some of that data with you in just a moment. So this pandemic, in a paradoxical way, has encouraged us to promote social justice. And that's a refreshing thing in the middle of all of this. In 2017 and 18, 5,500 young people aged 10 and over were under youth justice supervision on an average day. 18% were in detention, and of those, 60% were on sentence, and 50% were Indigenous. Most of you knew, but you may not have felt that 10-year-olds can be charged as an adult. And the legislative chain that's being asked by Black Lives Matter is to raise that to 14. And I'm not sure that's even more, comes close to Black Lives Mattering, but it looks like children's lives might matter. If it took a pandemic for us to spend time together, which maybe you've had the chance to do with the people around you, to generate this possibility of social justice at this time, to enable a single mom in Sydney who now makes $70 extra a week because of Job Seeker, so she can afford lunch for her kids who take their lunch to school rather than skipping it. Think about that. It took the pandemic for a mom to have enough money for her kids to have lunch. If it took a pandemic for bike sales to increase and for families to enjoy the opportunity to ride bicycles, if it took a pandemic to spend more time with each other just chilling, it's going to take a university to be the hub of transdisciplinary engagement and impact around the major issues of our time. This is just a diagram of the ministerial offices of the federal government and all of their extra people, and on the right, all the branches that talk to one another. Government is in silos, and good people are working hard to provide for us the services needed, and some really good things have happened, very progressive things that have happened that have kept us going. But those silos don't solve problems. They actually might actually address them in ways that are separate and disparate. And it's going to take a university to help solve the big problems, such as the reality that actually the most vulnerable are now more vulnerable. Our big issues are even bigger issues. The well-being of individuals and our society is actually potentially in crisis, and that we must urgently attend to the social justice issues of our times, not kick the can down the road and address them in and on our watch. The values of this university that Alex shared earlier, excellence, equity, engagement and sustainability are perfectly mapped to reach this challenge of what a modern university does. It rises up to solve big problems and to impact our communities. And our transdisciplinary engagement priorities of better, healthy living, next-gen resources, connected communities, and growing industries allow our research to map to the growing issues we're facing during this pandemic and will from here. I just want to, in closing, pick two of those big issues. Each of you might pick a different two. So I'll let you take that on next time. Let's pick, after this pandemic, what two issues does John think are really going to be left over to deal with? Climate change and social change. So you've seen the pictures, and Nathan hinted at this in an acknowledgement. This is New Delhi. This is Venice and Milan and the air quality in really polluted cities that over the last few months you might have been able to breathe. This is the nitrogen dioxide level in China between January and February when they went into lockdown. And as a result of that, 4,000 children under the age 5 and 73,000 adults over 70 didn't die because their breathing was actually humanly possible. But post-COVID, the hints of dirty recovery in China, because some of the rules have been relaxed and they're just turning the industry back on, polluters are now becoming bolder than ever because of the notion of economic growth. There's a free-for-all in the Amazon where 25% extra of the Amazon rainforest, which not only produces a really high percentage of oxygen for the rest of us, and pharmaceutical products and great innovations come out of the Amazon jungle, there's 25% extra being cut down now than was a year ago, as the president of Brazil just goes back to business. And in the U.S., there's been relaxed environmental protection rules, including weakening controls on mercury, which is being allowed to be spewed at record rates into the atmosphere so that jobs can be created by industries cranking back up. That post-COVID is going to be a serious issue that we have to deal with. However, it's a good thing we have the University of Newcastle, because you might know we have fantastic research, for example, in the area of building these flexible wallpaper-like solar panels that Professor Paul Duster is leading his team on right here on this campus. And in doing so, potentially are able to, without fossil fuels, create power supply for rural areas and remote areas, and also without the burden of carbon footprint. We have Dr. Danielle Verdon-Kidd from the School of Environmental and Life Sciences looking at climate extremes and how to manage those and predict those and facilitate those. We have nanotechnology by one of the world's great experts, Global Innovation Chair Professor Vinu, who's working with this nanotechnology that if someone smarter than me could explain, I would appreciate it, but it allows us to capture carbon from the air and turn it into potentially hydrogen and other such things which would make us less reliant on fossil fuels. We have historians looking at the connections between the Spanish flu and what we learned and what we can grow from today with Kate Ariadne and Professor Nancy Cushing, who are working together to help us understand what we can learn and grow from. And in the area of social change, we have colleagues such as Emeritus Professor Bill Mitchell mapping the economic and disadvantage in Australia and doing tremendous work in helping us understand where there's pockets of real suffering amongst our fellow Australians. And heroes like Professor Linda Ryan, who with her team has been mapping the massacres of Australia's colonial frontier and tracing for us a legacy that's gone silent for too long and allowing us from here to continue to evolve a true understanding of what inequity looks like and how much we have to overcome that for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people and for the righteous fairness of the Australian creed. We have Professor Tanya Sorden, the head of school and dean in the Newcastle Law School, really worried about court's ability to handle a post-COVID environment. And we have right here with our wonderful law students who have taken leadership to really promote Black Lives Matter. So as we look ahead, I want to close with the CEOs of both Woolies and Coles as they proceeded to figure out how to get enough food to areas of Australia right as the pandemic was hitting its peak, at least peak number one. And they, Woolworths, for example, directed suppliers to take food into the Northern Territory to places there aren't any Woolworths. They said, we don't care about the profits. We want food to go where people need it. Working with suppliers and retailers and IGAs they don't even usually do business with. Woolworths has no store in that area. They just had a corporate mindset of let's do the right thing. And this is the quote that really stuck with me, that it's not about our sales, it's about Australia. And I think the University of Newcastle represents to me doing the right things to overcome the injustices of the past, to promote equity and excellence, sustainability, engagement, and to live the dream of the hero, some of the heroes of the 20th century whose legacy lives on. And as I got the chance to take this photo at Uluru about 3 years ago, back was back when we used to be able to travel, you might remember that, I'm struck by the shrine it is for the legacy of 60,000 years, and I'm wondering what in 60,000 years the humans and the robots that tell them what to do will be thinking about how we've responded to this crisis. We have the opportunity in front of us through our interdisciplinary, transdisciplinary university to help make things better. Thank you very much. For the audience at home and the audience in the room, if you'd like to ask questions of our panel and of me as we go forward for the next half hour or so, if you take your phone up to the QR code, you should be able to launch a device which will allow you to ask a question. We'd look forward to those, and the team here will pass them to me and we'll see if we can't get to many of them. So at this time, I'd love to have our panel join me at the front of our nursing lecture theater. We have Nathan Towney, who you met earlier this evening, who did the acknowledgement, and Rue, who is our student from mechanical engineering, who you've already met, Professor Francis K. Lampton, who is our acting Pro Vice Chancellor of Research and Innovation, and a specialist and expert in mental health issues, and Professor Penny Jane Burke, who's the director of the Center of Excellence for Equity in Higher Education here at the university and a Global Innovation Chair of Equity. We'll just do a little mic check. Everybody good?
I'm good.
Thank you for joining. And I wanted to start off by asking each of you fairly briefly just to share so many reactions. You just heard me share a whirlwind of ideas and concepts and this notion of paradox. What resonated to you or what would you like to share just in reaction? And then I'll come back around for some specific things you really wanted to say in just a few minutes. Francis, do you mind starting?
Not at all. Thanks for the opportunity and thanks for that great introduction and scene setting to 2020, which I'm still trying to wrap my head around. And I think for me, one of the real paradoxes of 2020 has been that the very measures that we've had to come together as a community and implement in terms of being at home, staying at home, locking down, staying out of circulation may well have contributed to those increases in the mental health distress and the anxiety and the increase in our suicide rates that we'll be expecting. So we've saved lives in the very early days of COVID, and I feel that the second wave that we will really need to get on top of and get ahead of will be bending that second curve of mental illness going forward.
Did the data I share concur with some of the things you're more the expert in?
Unfortunately, it did. And I think for us, quite rightly, people were frightened and were warned against accessing the usual services, even emergency services and emergency departments that they might have ordinarily accessed through COVID. That hasn't happened. It's been reduced by about 30% during the peak of the infection period here in Newcastle, at least. But it doesn't mean that those issues aren't still there. It just means people aren't seeking treatment for them. And the impact of that is going to be quite serious.
Thanks, Frances. Any just general reactions? Because you hadn't seen any of that. What do you think? What was clicking in your mind?
Well, there's a lot there to reflect on. But I think one of the things that I've been really interested in, and what's come out from your talk, is the ways in which certain things have become visible through COVID. Mm-hmm. So I think you were able to show and demonstrate some of those things that became visible across inequities and across social injustices. But my concern, and I suppose herein lies the paradox, is that while these things have become visible, there's still so much that is invisible behind them. Mm-hmm. And we have so much work to do around social change to dig down and to understand the root causes of those visibilities that we've been able to see. And although some of those have become visible, my worry is that a lot of that visibility is about really long-standing historical inequalities that suddenly have become visible to us and also have been speakable to us because people in more privileged positions have been able to speak of those inequities that they've experienced. And secondly, that moving forward, we're going to lose sight of them as well. So I think we have a lot of work to do, but I really thank you for bringing those out in your talk.
Ruth, does anything resonate with you from what I just threw at you?
Yeah, I think this has been, just this whole lecture series is actually incredible to step outside of ourselves, because I think sometimes as human beings, we have this tendency to believe that the way in which we are experiencing the world can and should be universal. And when you're, you know, going through a really dark time, which COVID-19 has really been for a lot of people, we think that everyone else is going through the same thing. It's almost like a safety mechanism to think everyone is going through the same thing, which a lot of people have been. So it is good to, you know, take a look and hear people who have had contrary experiences. And I guess on the other side, when we have experienced the world in a way that has been very privileged and, you know, we're very well off, as you said, showed that a lot of the families who have shared these incredible stories of getting closer through COVID have been people who were well off to begin with. And I think it would be very interesting for these people who have seen and experienced the world in this light to take a step back and be like, whoa, you know, people are experiencing the world in a way that is different to me. And I've noticed that so much in my circles and my friends, when we do start to talk about, you know, Black Lives Matter and social change, and people are shocked. They're like, oh, you've experienced that? Because sometimes we shield ourselves and believe that the way we are experiencing the world is universal. So it's so great to have talks like this, where we have the ability to step outside of ourselves.
One of the words you used that I didn't use tonight was going to be one of the titles originally, The Paradox of Privilege. And I think what makes the University of Newcastle unique, and you hinted that in your earlier words when we started this evening, is the focus on equity and excellence allows us to use our big stage and platform for the common good, not just for the citations, you know, the publications and the rankings, but actually to impact our society. And I think that notion of privilege is that we don't take it for granted.
Absolutely.
Yep. Thank you. Nathan?
Yeah, thanks, John. And just for the audience, John didn't allow us to prepare anything for this and didn't let us see the presentation beforehand, which is really good, because what I thought I would say in this little reaction to what I hadn't seen is very different to how I am going to react. But thank you. It was really interesting and very thought-provoking. And I think what you captured and what the other panel members have captured, that our world pre-COVID wasn't perfect. And for a lot of minority groups, we can't afford to go back to how things were post-COVID. And I think that's really important. If you look at some of the stats that you put up around incarceration rates of Indigenous people in this country, and particularly in juvenile justice centres, if you just took the Northern Territory and the stats in the Northern Territory, that 50% becomes 100%. And so You know, and you look at raising the age from 10 to 14, when you look at the figures in the Northern Territory, it will blow people's mind that, you know, why don't we know about this, and what can we do to shift and change that thinking? And I guess the paradox for me in Aboriginal communities, and you know, we always hear about closing the gap, and we talk about a lot of the time Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people are spoken about in a negative tone, and that, you know, they need fixing. And you know, I think what is really exciting through this COVID is that the way that Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people have been able to support each other. You know, out of, we make up just over 3% of the population in Australia, and yet we've accounted for less than 0.5% of COVID cases. And, you know, that's not by accident. Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people traditionally have a far greater concern for community, mm-hmm. for country. And so that's really come to light, especially in our regional and remote communities, where, you know, we've been lucky enough to not have any COVID cases, and we can't afford to have COVID cases there. So it's, you know, I think it's, yeah, it's really interesting, all everything that you've talked about.
Yep. Thank you all. So now we'll rotate through each panel member, and following this rotation, we'll see what questions we have from our audience out there and come back to you. What I've asked you to do is to, you knew the topic of the paradox of a pandemic, and you prepared a couple of things you wanted to share, and if it's altered a bit, no worries. We can alter it just a bit. Penny, do you mind starting?
No, that's fine. So this was a hard exercise.
Yeah.
But I suppose what I really wanted to focus around was the paradox of COVID-19 around the enforced isolation and distancing, which then generated an understanding of our absolute human need for connection. So while we were enforced, you know, we were experiencing enforced isolation, we understood how important it is for our humanity to be connected with each other. And I guess I'm speaking in the context of my own work in my field, which is equity and social justice. But of course, it goes beyond that. And in order to achieve equity and social justice, we absolutely need connection. In fact, we can't learn without connection in the first place. So our sense of relationality to one another is absolutely crucial, but is often one of those invisibilities that we don't talk about. And I think in association with that is another paradox that's not about COVID, but is about our contemporary understanding of ourselves and our lives, which operates around a notion of individualism. So everything does seem to me to be through the lens of individualism, whether that's about individual choice or individual success or individual aspiration or individual confidence or individual resilience and so on. And this overshadows to a large extent this necessity of our human lives for connection, for being in relation to the other, for being in relation to the world, which we all need so much. So that, I think that insight that has come from a pandemic, the paradox of the pandemic around enforced isolation, making us reach out and find new ways of connection have been really, really important. And in the Center of Excellence for Equity in Higher Education, which is, I'll call CEHE for short, we've had to struggle to find ways of connecting with people in very precarious and very vulnerable situations. One of our programs, Reclaim My Place, is about reaching out and connecting with women who are in spaces of trauma and despair. And this has been exacerbated by COVID-19. And the women are experiencing this trauma and despair because of another global pandemic, which is the global pandemic of gendered violence against women. Mm. And that pandemic also operates around enforced isolation and distancing and disconnection. But that is as a weapon of control and abuse. So through Reclaim My Place, I want to say our, because it's very much about this connection, mm-hmm. We had to find ways to rediscover ways of connecting. And I think the paradox is that together, through co-development, through working together collaboratively across our differences, we were able to enrich and extend the forms of connection that pre-COVID didn't exist, which I think is really interesting. So, the participants in this process were from very different positioning. Some were university representatives, some were professional care workers, and some were women who had experienced the trauma of domestic and family violence. But together, they were able to develop really powerful forms of connection. Now, what I want to argue is that that was because Reclaim My Place was always premised on a foundation of relationality and not individualism, of a sense of mutuality, of a sense of mutual respect, reciprocity, mutual care, mutual support. And that foundation is what enabled the co-participants to develop really powerful forms of connection. So what I want to just say is that although there were lots of attempts, and I think people did amazing work during this extreme situation of the COVID lockdown to find ways of connection, moving forward and thinking about questions of equity and social justice and social change, we really need to move towards our sense of connection with each other, towards frameworks of relationality, and moving away from very strong focus on individualism in order to stay connected through all of the inevitable challenges that lie ahead for us.
Yeah. Thank you, Benny. Let's pause for a moment. That's a lot to take in. It's pretty confronting in all the ways that we need to be confronted. Nathan, do you mind following up? I know we might go a different direction.
Yeah, I think it sort of builds on, and I want to refer back to a slide that you put up about a chance to reset. Mm. And I think individuals are looking at ways that we can reset and prioritise what's important in our lives. But I think as a society, we need to reset. It allows us an opportunity to really think about what's important, the laws and the policies that we have in place, and think about what they encourage, what they discourage, and the opportunities that exist now to maybe make things right. Yeah. Mm. And how do we make those things happen? Who's going to take the lead? You know, have we got the right people in the right places across the globe to really make that shift and change? And, you know, I think it's scary when you look around the globe at some of the people that we have in positions of power, but we need places like universities to build a movement and a momentum of good people to stand up for what's right and to stand up for those people that haven't been spoken about or for too long. And so I guess I just wasn't in a direction that I planned to go, but I think that concept of resetting individually, but also as a community and as a society, we can't miss this opportunity. And how do we get the right people to be the voice to make that change?
Mm. Nathan, you were also reminded me of things in the reset that if we think about what a lot of young people have been told during the time that they were away from school, and I realize around the world, North America, South America, Africa, the peak hasn't even happened yet. So we're talking about a real event in real time for all of us. We're worried about young people being behind. My answer is behind what? Behind an arbitrary list of curriculum guides that were created by people who are trying to sort young people into different versions of themselves, as opposed to doing some of what you and Penny have just said, which is to create opportunity, expand potential, and actually then not put pressure on them that something's wrong with them because we happen to exist in a once in a century pandemic. So I think what you've just said is use this chance to not just reset, reposition ourselves moving forward, which is really powerful.
I think if everybody takes the opportunity to reset as an individual, that contributes to resetting our community and our society and people standing up for what they believe is important.
Yeah. Particularly for people with privilege, to not waste that privilege on the trivial and really make sure we take advantage of the opportunity we have. That's the values of this university, which I think has brought most everybody here or keeps them here.
I think that's really powerful when you talk about resetting and taking this time to reset and understanding the implications that we as individuals have in our societies. I think we have gone so long in a very individualistic mindset, and you know, this is my life, my job, you know, doesn't affect anyone. And all of a sudden there is this global pandemic where we're asked to stay home, not just for ourselves, but for the other people that are in our communities. And I think for the first time in a really long time, on a grand scale, we have been forced to reckon with the implications of our actions and even just our being on other people. There's a saying that says, injustice against one is injustice against all. And it's funny that it took a pandemic for us to understand that, because all of a sudden we have people who are standing up for issues and causes that would never affect them. You know, I went to the Black Lives Matter protest, and I was standing alongside people who may never have experienced racism or discrimination, but yet they stood there, because for the first time in a really long time on a global scale, we began to understand that our actions and our presence sometimes actually has an impact on other people. And we're also starting to understand that a lot of these things are systematic. A lot of these things have come from much longer than before us, because I think in this mass social awakening, a lot of people have been like, okay, then what do I do? And it's very difficult, because a lot of these issues are not issues that we created. We were born into this. Sometimes I say, you know, it's almost like you were born into the world and everything's wrong, and you're like, oh my gosh, can I go back? Can I restart? But we were born into these things, and now we are forced to reckon with the world that we were born into, and forced to take ownership of something that we did not create, but we have been perpetuating by simply just being here. And so I think it's so powerful for us, as Nathan says, to reset ourselves as individuals and then understand the implications that we have on other people and this world that we are living in.
John, can I just add, it gives me hope. When I talk about, you know, we maybe don't have the leaders at the moment, to hear our youth speak like this gives me really good hope that, you know, we're in with a good future.
Thank you.
Yeah. And you're still in your younger days too, Nathan, so don't catch yourself out.
Thanks.
Francis?
As am I.
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, thank you. I've just really enjoyed listening to everybody's perspective, and I think that's probably what I've done most during COVID, is stopped and listened to people that I just haven't had the opportunity or made time to do so, and I've really appreciated that. For me, with a focus on mental health and mental illness, there's always been a struggle in helping people understand just what the impact is. We've always known, I guess, the statistics that one in five people will develop a mental disorder at some stage in their lives. But with the rapid disruptive transformation that COVID's brought into our society, I doubt there is any household in Australia that is untouched by mental illness at this point in time. And whilst that's alarming, it's worrying, and we're at a bit of an impasse as to what we're going to do about that. What it rapidly has done has really broken down the stigma around mental illness, because you can't get away from it when it's in your house and you're confronted with it in the way that we've been talking about tonight. And what's interesting about that is that it's almost taken COVID for this rapid disruptive transformation to occur, for us all to start to accept mental illness as part of our society. I'm having conversations about mental illness every day when I could go many days without doing that. What we've also seen along with that is this tendency, as I referred to before, of us not actually then knowing what to do about that, not being comfortable to access our regular treatment services or having access to our regular support services, or not being able to escape from some of the toxic environments that we're living in. And for many years, my colleagues and I in mental health and mental illness have really been trying to advocate strongly for rapid mental health system reform.
and it's taken COVID-19 to actually start the process of that rapid system transformation, and telehealth and technology has been the key. We've again been struggling for years to try to encourage the integration of technology into the provision of healthcare and mental health services. And really, we've had great success in doing so in our research trials and in our research practices, but just haven't made that impact in implementation, which is why we all get out of bed and do research in the first place. But with this rapid disruptive transformation, the government has made available telehealth and really shone a spotlight on the benefits and potential of technology to rapidly bring people together and connect. And so, and again, young people are the most avid users of technology. So again, the people who are potentially most affected by mental illness and by the impacts of COVID-19 are also the ones who are most likely to have access to the technology that's actually going to help steer them through this crisis. Yep. So we're kind of cautiously optimistic, I guess, at the same time about being able to navigate the huge challenges for mental illness and mental health and wellbeing that COVID has presented with us because of the rapid disruptive transformation that it has forced everybody to undertake in the way that we conceive of and deliver our mental health services. And what's been, I don't know if I say interesting, if that's the right word, but we've had really no great data or no models of how you do this. And so in healthcare or healthcare implementation. And so the community has come to researchers who've been doing this in our research trials for quite some time for that kind of guidance. And I love that connection back for research and having its impact.
Thank you. During our last few minutes, we have about 8 minutes left in our window before the meter runs out on our teleconference for the evening. We're going to do a little rapid fire from questions from our audience, both here and around the world that are tuned in. So we'll ask to just keep the answers brief, rapid fire, and we'll see if I can keep up. So this question is for Rue. Do you think that people who come from less advantage or privilege are better able to cope in the COVID-19 times due to their resilience, and perhaps their less privileged position gives them a chance to make it through a little bit without as much stress as others?
I think you cannot generalize, and I think in social change, one of the things that we are moving away from is generalizing black and brown people as one individual. So I think you can't generalize, but I think I'll speak specifically for me, and I know that a lot of black people have had this experience of being young and being told you have to be twice as good to get the same opportunities and work twice as hard for the same roles. And so I think even in that, so from very young ages, we are aware that the way we experience the world is not the way that other people are going to experience it. And so almost as a coping mechanism, our parents teach us resilience so we can get through the world, because they know what they have had to push through and get through, only to be seen as equal, or even sometimes for them as less equal. And so in almost trying to prepare us for this big white world, they put lots of resilience into us and teach us these techniques and tools of being able to cope. So I do think that resilience is something that is in a lot of black and brown communities, and I think the support that we have within having communities that are very strong and tight-knit help us to get through things that can be very shattering for other communities that may be more individualistic.
Thank you. This question is for Francis. Given all of what you've said, do you think there's some positive aspects to the fact that many people have now created a work-life balance that allows them actually to be home a little bit more and maybe not as stressed out from all the going and coming of going to work?
I really hope that that's true, and I've certainly been able to see that happening in many of the families that are in my little circle. And I think COVID-19 has really generated a sense of real humility about our place in the world and humility about the things that we value. And I think that's changed a lot, as we've talked about already tonight. And certainly this idea of flexibility in the way that we conduct our business and the way we conduct ourselves in the world has changed rapidly, and the world hasn't ended. So I think that yes, there are some positives, and there are definitely some things that I do hope we retain and carry forward into normal X.
Thank you. This question is for Penny. It's about individualism that you mentioned. And if we compare to the Spanish flu in 1819 to 100 years later, do you see that role of individualism has changed? Are we better or worse off to be able to rise together as a community through this? Or do you think it's the other way and actually our individualism is more about me as opposed to us?
That's a really, really difficult question to answer, I think. But I think that, interestingly, a sense of crisis, shifts our orientation. So although I think that individualism is heavily embedded in our kind of culture, our Western culture, I think that experience did shift to some extent our orientation to that. What worries me is that I feel like we shift very quickly, very rapidly back to something that we call normal, which isn't necessarily normal, it's a construction. So whether or not we've dealt differently from before, I don't know, but I think that what has happened is that there's a much more powerful, specific, and explicit notion of individualism, which is different from maybe other historical notions of individualism from previous times. And so, you know, if we think about even the concept of work ready as being the ultimate goal of the new of the normal, the return to normal, that's a form of individualism that isn't acknowledging all the other aspects of human lives that you were able to foreground in your lecture today, John. All the different kinds of aspects that people bring to their communities, that people share, that are invisibilized by that one focus. And I'm really proud that our university talks about life ready, because I think that's a really important concept, because it broadens the notion about engagement and what we're educating people for, what the purpose of higher education is. And I think that needs to be part of our conversation as well. So I haven't really addressed the question, but I think that we learned something through this particular lockdown period about the need for our connection and moving away from individualism. My hope is that we can hold on to some of those insights and understandings moving forward.
Thank you. We just have a couple minutes. I'm going to ask you a one-word answer in a minute. But Nathan, this question comes around the opportunities for employment in the future. You've been studying some of that, particularly around indigenous employment, but more broadly, what are the opportunities for employment as we move through this that gives young people hope that their education is going to pay off at the other side?
Yeah, I think if you'd asked this question 12 months ago, the answer would be very different, because I think this pandemic has really shifted and changed the world's going to operate moving forward. Mm. So if you'd have asked me this 12 months ago, I would have talked about the world being a very small place and you know, the globe being accessed frequently and easily, and who knows what it's going to look like moving forward. So I think in terms of what Penny said, in terms of life ready, is the most important aspect that we can focus on in education. And I think that young people need to concentrate on those skills that allow them to work well with people, are able to adapt to change, and all those what historically have been called soft skills that we know are so important in whatever field of work that you go into. And so I think in terms of being prepared for work for the future, it's all those skills that young people need to really focus on.
Thank you, Nathan. All right. This is really rapid fire with full rules in force. One or two words that represent this paradox to you, as a human going through this. What do you think? What would be your final couple of words as you think about this paradox? What do you think of?
I think possibility, vision.
Right.
Change?
Right,
can I have three words?
I'm having three.
You've got to have three, but you got 30 seconds.
Uncomfortable, necessary transformation.
Okay, thank you.
I would say opportunity.
Yeah, for me it's realignment of priorities.
Excellent. Mine would be hope and clean. My hands have never been cleaner. I've got hand sanitizer in all aspects of all my crevices, I think. On behalf of our panel, it's truly been an honor to be with you tonight and to launch this inaugural series of the Looking Ahead lecture series. Thank you to all of you for coming, particularly to Sarah and Jess for helping put this together, our IT team who's made it all work, and to all of you for all you do every day to keep hope alive through a very unusual time. I want to tip that August 25th, Professor Frances K. Lempton will be doing the second of our lecture series, and she'll carry forward this discussion of this vital nature of how we're going and the mental health issues facing Australia and the world that are reeling and making many of us suffer, but the opportunity through some of the great research done here at the University of Newcastle to help us get through this. So on behalf of all of us here and all of us out in the internet land, we thank you for coming, we wish you well, and we look forward to seeing you in person down the road on any of our campuses around the world as we celebrate the opportunity for the University of Newcastle to look ahead. Thanks very much.